Good morning.
Good morning, Ravi. How are you?
All right. So, better a bit louder. That's fine. Okay. Well, I think I would like to have a small interview with you because you have some experience in a personal experience encounters with Aborigines in Australia. So, I'm sure that the purpose of the interview to highlight the lifestyle of these Aborigines and your experience out of that. Okay. First of all, I want you to introduce yourself.
Thank you. My background is my name is Anil Kumar Gupta. I was born in 1960 in Bangalore, India, to parents from Punjab. We are originally my family moved from Amritsar in Punjab to live in Bangalore after the partition. So I did my engineering at BMS College of Engineering in Bangalore and graduated as an electronic engineer. Subsequently joined the family business, which contains industry, trade in Bangalore, and worked with the family for several years. And whatever, decided to move to Australia. 10 years back, we moved from Bangalore to Cairns, where I did my master's in business management at James Cook University, Cairns. And subsequently, I got an opportunity to work with the Lakehart River Aboriginal Shire Council up in the Cape. Now, this is approximately around 900 odd kilometers north of Cairns. It's in a secluded area, a very pretty area of the Cape, part of Australia. And it's a small community of about 800 to 900 people, approximately. This community has its own Shire Council, and I was employed as their Director of Engineering to look after the entire Shire infrastructure. Now, most of the employees of the council are Aboriginal people, and predominantly this is an Aboriginal settlement. I had almost about 50 Aborigine people reporting to me, and that's how I started my first experience talking to them, meeting them, living in their community, and also interacting with them. You know, what we read about, what we hear, so I had my own apprehensions when I moved to Lockhart River, and but within a couple of days I was made very comfortable. I enjoyed talking to them, they enjoyed listening to my stories and my background, and also, of course, you know, we are there for a job to get an outcome, and they were very keen to work together to create that outcome. Predominantly, the Aborigines, in my opinion, they're very, you know, happy-go-lucky people. Predominantly fearless, they have no fear of virtually anything. Few things they are scared of, like simple things, they are very scared of electricity. They are not scared of any kind of neither crocodiles. There are hundreds and thousands of crocodiles in that Lockhart and the Cape region. Crocodiles don't bother them, they don't bother the crocodiles, neither the snakes or any of the normal, you know, we have the predators in the wild. And that's why very rarely you'll see an indigenous person or an Aborigine being an electrician. They are just, for some reason, they just scares them out. But having said that, there are always exceptions, but predominantly that's one of their main scares. Overall, working with them has been beautiful. They are lovely people. They are very interested, thirsting for knowledge. They do carry a bit of a chip on their shoulder about having had this disadvantage in Australian society. They were not recognized in the constitution. So there's a lot of this in their minds, and a lot of it also has to do, in my opinion, with the press. And very rarely people have actually engaged with them to kind of question them as well as to what their expectations are. And, you know, they live in the wild very happily, very comfortably. You ask them to camp for 10, 12 days or a month or 3 months in the wild, virtually without nothing, it's like fish in water. They are very comfortable. They don't need anything. They work with the land. They drink the water, creek water. Nothing happens to them. They eat the berries and the, you know, the food from the forest. They know how to, you know, get fish. They know how to get the meat from some of the animals. They know how to, you know, cull the cows. It's they can survive, and they can survive very well, and they really like it. In my opinion, I think it has been for them, it's like this is a new Australian life they've been introduced to, that you have a house, you have electricity, you need to have clean water, you need to have toilets, you need to have a deck, and you go to a supermarket to buy your meat. Now the meat in Cape could have come mostly from either Victoria or somewhere else, but there's meat right in their backyard. So it is a bit, I think they're quite confused as to what is, you know, what is the right way for them to live. And that confusion then leads to a bit of, at times, anger, because there are not too many jobs. The council, we had employed about, I mean, as I said, about, I had about almost 50 people or so working for me. And from people in the road department, people in the trades maintaining the buildings, the plumbers, of course, part of the building crew. Then we had people in the parks and gardens. Then I had people in the workshop. So a wide spectrum of people required for the council, to run a council. And this, different people had different needs and different training, different ideas and different kind of career opportunities. But there are a lot of frustration, because they learn a bit living in the community, but there are a lot of skills required which you need from mainstream community. And it's funny, sometimes they get an opportunity to go out, but they can't go out because of some family commitments. They are a very highly family-oriented people. For them, family does not necessarily mean the parents and their partner and their children, typically. It is a significant extended family. Uncles, aunts, nephews, nieces, cousins, first cousins, second cousins, mean a lot to them. I've seen personally, in when one of my boys who had gone out fishing on one weekend, he came back with another mate of his. That this guy was a person from the European background, and they brought back about some 8 fishes. So this Aborigine guy got about 6 of them, and the other fellow took 2. But I asked him how they were, and he said, "I don't know. I never got to eat them, because I mean, he gave all of them to his relatives. I mean, most of it was cooked at home, but everybody came in for a feast and everybody enjoyed their dinner. And he never even got a taste to eat it. And he said, I had to go to the store and get some, you know, dinner for myself." So I found that really kind of, to me, I mean, our culture from India is to a great extent similar, but we also always get a feed for ourselves. But here, I found it fantastic to hear that this guy could actually do this. So it shows to me their high amount of empathy for their people, for their, you know, their own community, and sharing. They are very sharing. They have seen at times when I've gone for an inspection to some of the houses, there's supposed to be 3 or 4 people living in there. And you go there and there are about 10. And they had the confidence in me that I'm not going to create any problems for them, so they had no issues in actually introducing me to all of them. And it seemed that all of them were staying with them for several months. And these are people who have come from other different parts of the Cape, who have come for a few days, end up staying there, they like it. They get indulged by their, you know, relatives in terms of uncles, aunts or whoever it is. And they stay on for a few months, enjoy their hospitality and also give back as well. One guy was a bit of, he was hands-on, he could do a bit of gardening and things like that. So he actually helped spruce up the whole yard, and I was quite impressed, because one of the things from a council engineer perspective, it's important for me to motivate people to keep their yards clean from environmental health perspective, and also from safety, because snakes do tend to like hiding in tall grass and bushes. So it was fantastic to see that, and well, I did encourage that guy to even look at, you know, maintaining a few yards around the street. So I think things like these, it's quite something which we don't read in the books, we don't realize what is happening, but seeing it physically firsthand, did touch a lot in me that, you know, I need to work with them a lot more. I want to help them. I want to kind of see how we can make a difference to their lifestyle and also provide them with opportunity for proper training, which is applied training. And many times there is opportunity for them to do the training, but it never happens. I'll give an example. Like some of the boys had been working on these graders and rollers for the roads for several years, and at several times they've had minor training on this, on a small item for this, but none of them had actually overall earned a full regular qualification, what is called a ticket in Australia, to have like a ticket to run a dozer or a ticket to run a roller or an excavator or a grader. They had never gone to that extent to actually finish it. From what I could understand, the previous engineers and the council have been saying that yes, we will do it. It never happened. And one of the curious things which I found with these Aborigine people is that it is when you talk to them, they ask you once about, you know, can I have this ticket, I want training, and you say yes, but you don't go anywhere. Rarely they come back to question you and, you know, argue with you or debate it with you as to why I'm not getting it. But some, when they do come back and you push them back again saying yes, I'll walk it out, I'll organize it, they go back and they never really, you know, kind of insist. Whereas I've seen that in our kind of society, we keep going back, we keep saying, oh no, we want to, we have to, and how can we do it and what it is. These guys are very gentle. I think that they call it like, you know, for them it is almost, they feel that it's a lack of confidence, in my opinion, in themselves, a lack of self-esteem sometimes I see with them. And it is all basically nothing to do with their ability, actual ability to perform. They're very clever people. But it's just, I think, they very easily give up. And that, to me, was quite a learning to see how they predominantly, that's how they behave. And but if you kind of work with them and, you know, kind of push them a little bit, like, I was fortunate enough to, you know, locate funding to make sure that, you know, these boys got their tickets. And it happened, and it finally did happen in spite of all, you know, political and bureaucratic, you know, things which happen in councils. But that won me a lot of, you know, kind of support from the Aborigines. And they still have those tickets. And I was lucky that after my stint at Lockhart River, I got a, you know, work with the Queensland government to look after water and wastewater infrastructure in these indigenous communities. So I did go back to Lockhart River and several other communities to engage. So the last three and a half years, I worked in engaging with them and creating these outcomes. And I find that, again, it's like you walk with them to get them something, and they want to walk. Of course, there are always exceptions. There's exception to every rule, in my opinion. And that you'll find people who are a bit self-motivated. There are fewer, and you also have people who are not motivated at all. How much ever you work with them and do with them, they really, at the end of the day, they really, you know, they're not that interested.
Do they follow rules? For example, do they come in time to work, and or they will leave in the time, or they, you know, what way their behavior as work practices?
See, generally they don't. Generally they don't. And also it is also to do with, they have been let loose with this, you know. They have their own timings. They, like, we call them the, I mean, they joke about it themselves. They call it the Murray time. And Murray time.
Okay.
So it's I think spelled Murray, M-U-R-R-A-Y. And I was also first couple of times taken aback. I didn't know what it meant. But I clarified with them. He said Murray time means, you know, when we say 8 o'clock, it could be 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. It depends on our moods to show up at that time. But that is a perception. But if you explain to them that you need to come, you know, I would like to see you there at this time, more often than not, they are there. there are times when they come earlier as well. But again, it's something which I think we need to kind of understand that they have a lot of, you see, inbuilt volcanic feelings which they don't let out. They're bursting from inside to express themselves, say some things, but they are not able to because they don't know, they're scared to actually explain anything to them and say things to them, I mean to others.
Most of my casual workers are they?
Most of them are, but quite a few of them have permanent jobs as well. But at the same time, permanent jobs in a council, it depends on how you look at it. But in an indigenous council, it is easier to three strike rule, is the same rule for all the councils, but kind of ask people that they want to go, they can go. And most of the time, if they themselves are fed up, they just walk away. They're not looking too much, I'm entitled to this. I have so much of leave. They, of course, want it. They want as much money as they can get, but they don't argue. That's, it's fine. It's over. I'm over with it. I'm gone. Maybe 6 months later, they come back.
Then they go. Who is looking out the families? They lost income?
There's lost income, but I think most of the time, Centrelink has a very good system for the Aboriginal people. And they get money from Centrelink that you lost a job and, you get back onto the dole. And there's a fair bit of benefit from the Centrelink to these Aboriginal people. Like, I think it's almost same as almost every Australian, really. And their needs are not huge. When you think about it, very rarely you see them sitting in a coffee shop having a cup of coffee, spending that $5 on a coffee, or sitting in a restaurant and having a $50 meal. No, they're very happy going to a KFC or McDonald's or something similar, having a meal or cooking something themselves. And
how much alcoholism is a problem in their community?
It is. A lot of the communities up in the Cape, in Queensland, are dry. Some have limited carriage of alcohol, very limited. And I think one or two have a small pub in these communities. And there also it's limited. You get about, I think, three light beers or three mid-stem beers and things like that. And you can't have more than that. There's a lot of strong regulation. But alcoholism is a problem. But at the same time, it is not more than any which is there in any other community anywhere else. People like to have a drink. Some people drink in excess, it's the alcohol which starts talking, and then, people get into arguments and fights, and then they hit each other at times, and there have been cases of when people have been seriously injured in these fights.
But the ladies has a drink as well.
Oh yes, the ladies drink quite a lot as well. Yes, some of them really like to have a few drinks. And on the other hand, there are some who just like to have maybe a glass of wine or one beer, they're happy with that. So, but yes, I mean, there is this instance of men being aggressive and after a few drinks.
Is it a culture of Aborigines to drink from before the white man came?
There is, talking to these people, there doesn't seem to be a significant amount of evidence of them having, brewed alcoholic beverage. But there seems to be evidence of them, they talk about some of the elders speaking about. In the wild, there are a few fruits and a few leaves which have intoxicating characteristics. So people were kind of partaking in them for sure. And but again, I think earlier times the elders in the community and people had a lot more control over their, their group of people, and there was a little bit of, seemingly a bit of fear that you don't go too much out of line, and you get reprimanded. Even now, I have seen once or twice some of the elders kind of reprimanding the younger people, and the younger people listen to them. But that listening phase now is getting shorter and shorter. For 2-3 days they're okay, and then they slide back into their normal, kind of...
The kids also start to drink at very early age.
Yes, because there is no restriction, really. I mean, it's banned, so anything illegal, if it's there and the kids get it, and, well, really, there's nobody to watch them, really. And the parents at times are quite lax.
Glue sniffing?
Quite a bit of glue sniffing is there. Petrol sniffing is there. And now they're doing some on some paints. They sniff some of the paints, which are supposed to have these fumes.
But you're talking about small community, but they are, you know, they cannot organize themselves. And how do you find the future for these people? Because life expectancy dropping a lot?
Well, it is significantly less than the normal mainstream people, but it is getting a little better. The government is spending a lot of money in trying to treat them. But treating them is one aspect and preventing is another aspect. In my opinion, that prevention is there, but it's not... The entire focus is not a huge amount on prevention. Funnily, it's more on cure.
Who's responsibility preventing? The Aboriginal leaders or the government? Or who is responsible for this?
Actually, that's an interesting question. I mean, in my opinion, it should be both. It should be definitely self. There has to be something from the self to prevent. The elders and the leaders definitely need to, you know, show leadership in that perspective. And to some extent, and you see, the government has to also then back it up by saying, all right, we are here to help you and, you know, educate you to do the right thing and eat the right foods. There is a bit of initiative from the government as well. I mean, like encouraging people to eat more fruits, vegetables, and not just eat meat. And but again, it's, you see, they know for themselves in many ways what is good for them and what is not. And it's quite interesting that some of the elders really know what, you know, which tree gives what to them. I'll give an example. There's one guy in Warbinda Aboriginal Shire Council, which is in central Queensland. Now this boy is probably, he's not very old, he's probably about 30, 31. But the amount of experience he's got, he's lived in the bush, what they call here, like, you know, a bit more remote and with the land quite significantly. And he was quite a wild boy when he was younger, I believe. That's what he was telling me. These are things which he's told me himself. And he showed me a few plants, which when you rub, it gives you a soapy feeling. So it's like if your hands are dirty, all you need to do is rub your hands with these leaves and your hands are clean. You don't need soap. And he showed me another plant when we were doing one inspection, which grows a little bit away, and that plant seemed to have, again, the leaves of that and the sap coming out of that, when you rub it on your skin, it's like a moisturizer. And apart from moisturizer, it seems to, he showed me that it's kind of like an antiseptic also. It seems to, if you have any small minor skin kind of, you know, not an allergy, but the small skin issues, it seems to clear it. And he uses a lot of it for his kind of kids and his, you know, his family and things. So
the native medicines, actually every country has its own, but how much I think Aboriginal community have this promotion or something, you know, like in Sri Lanka or India, you have the Ayurvedic and you go to that, you don't go to the Western medication for small things, and you know control your diet and a few things like that, you can be done, simple things.
Yes.
So similarly, do they have alternative medicine there?
Not in the organized fashion as how we have in India and Sri Lanka and in a subcontinent area. No, not at all. It's, a lot of it is slowly starting to disappear as the elders, you know, kind of pass away. But there is a push to kind of document it and, you know, pass it on. This guy who was telling me about, the guy in Warbinda was telling me, I mean, it was interesting, I know, these are his words, and I'm not sure, I have not been able to verify it totally, but he says, we do not want to share this with, I mean, what he says, like, you know, I don't want to share it with the white people.
This is quite true, you know, that's what I heard as well, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So,
but, you know, in Australia, how many communities or different tribes are there?
Oh, there are
So each of them will have some wisdom, no? All these things are there. They don't have communication with the other races?
They do. They are also sort of, in some ways, related or, know somebody. They seem to have been, they have been quite nomadic. So people have moved from different states as well. So as I see that it is, this guy, for example, this boy I talked about from Warbinda, he seemed to have come from somewhere in New South Wales originally. But for some reason, his mom, I think, moved up to Queensland and she married somebody in Queensland. And that's how he continued to stay there. But he is related, and he spoke about quite a few people related in New South Wales and South Australia. He didn't mention much about Northern Territory, but I believe Northern Territory and Western Australia have a lot of significant culture as well among their own people. I hear about it when you speak to them, but there is not any formal sharing, but it is easy for them to link up with others. There is animosity with some tribes, but a lot of it is like sort of also easily lit up like fire. Otherwise they work together, they live together, they eat together, that's fine. But the moment somebody starts to say something and create the divide, then yes, things can go a bit crazy.
Now, how much the modern, for example, I'm talking about family lives, you know, how they get married and what kind of, you don't know how their system works. What age they marry and how many kids they have, and how they have, with one wife or more than one, how the system, who is doing what, you're not quite clear about all these things. Can you enlighten on some of these related to family?
Yeah, you see, to some extent, I probably don't know a huge amount, but what I know is that earlier days, their entire family system of, even arranging marriage and everything was very similar to what we have back home in India, Sri Lanka, subcontinent. Very similar, where people from, community used to arrange, like there were cross-community marriages were quite common, but at the same time, it was sort of arranged, hey, this one here. I think over the years, it seems to have slowly started to change, where people have, started to become more open, easy to kind of, move away as well. Where predominantly quite a few of the women seem to walk away from their husbands or, male partners and get away and say, I've had enough of you and you're too, whatever, boring, or you're just, not doing the right thing or whatever. And they walk away and they find a new partner. The men also, but a lot of the men do tend to stick with their partners as well. But there is a lot of, over the last maybe 15 years or 18 years or 20 years, they have started to become very, very loose with relationships. Predominantly, you see quite a few of them having several kids from, from two, three different women. The woman also walking away. It seems to be a little strange, but they seem to kind of also...
Is it a norm or exception? Actually, white society, there's an exception. Is it a norm there?
It is now becoming almost a norm. You see most of them having this kind of, relationships. Having at least two or three partners seems to be quite a norm with them. The exceptions are where women have had several, husbands, or men have had several, wives or something.
So there's no conflict, they were fighting over the woman, that kind of issue?
They do have. There, a lot of sometimes the fight is because of the woman and why this and this and this and that. But predominantly they seem to kind of manage that quite well. And somehow even the kids, even though they, the moms are away or the father's away, you see that very strong bonding with some of them, with their children.
Maybe grandmothers.
Grandmothers, yes, but even with the mothers or the fathers, some fathers are extremely passionate about their kids. One of them I saw very clearly was another guy in Warbinda itself, a different water operator. He's got two daughters, and he's separated from his partner or wife or the mother of these two girls. He doesn't have another woman yet in his life, and but he is so passionate about these girls. The girls live with him and not with the mom, and I couldn't understand why. And he said, "Well, my life is my two girls," and he puts
Are they
all his.
studying? Both girls are
Yes,
studying?
both are studying. He's pushing them, and I've also, when we have spoken and pushed him, I've mentored him also to kind of not let the ball down and say, "All right, this is what everybody else is not studying, so you know." And I said, "You must make an example of your girls, that if they can go through, finish year 12 and then go into university or even a TAFE course." University initially sounds very daunting to them, generally. For them to finish year 12 itself is quite an achievement. And I think it's good baby steps. When from year 12, then you start doing some TAFE courses. And a lot of them don't know what other courses they can do to actually get work or to have a fulfilling life.
Are they happy to move out from there to, let's say, for example, you have come from Sri Lanka, you are from India, moving around for so many countries. Are they prepared for work reason? Are they prepared to go to Brisbane or their place? Are they happy to go about?
Generally, yes, but I think from what I could understand is they have a bit of a fear inside them that will they manage to live in a big city? Will they manage to live a normal, mainstream life? They have a lot of that lack of self-confidence. A lot of things they end up doing is because they don't have the confidence to move out. Some of them do. It's not that nobody does. Some of them do. But they're more like a smaller percentage, like how you said, more exceptions rather than the normal rule.
Can you tell me something about ceremonies they have? It normally, you know, the smoking ceremonies or whatever related ceremonies they have, you know, probably you may have a little bit of experience on these things.
Lot of these ceremonies, they are quite what you call closed affairs. They are not very comfortable if you are there for the entire time. And I'm not sure why. I think for them it's also again a lack of whether we would appreciate their ceremony or would we feel that, you know, negativity coming there. And they would be happy actually to engage with us at the ceremony. One of the typical ceremonies which they have quite often is at the funerals. They are very passionate about how they bury their, you know, people who have passed away. They provide a lot of what do you call respect to the person who's gone. Even digging the grave and burying the people, there seems to be a big ceremony for them to do that. And also it is interesting when they drive the coffin around the community to take it to the burial grounds. There is a protocol how you stand, and if you are an indigenous Aborigine person, you behave differently. If you're a non-Aborigine, you're expected to behave very differently as well. You are not supposed to actually show too much of like a joyful expression on your face. You're supposed to stand solemnly, and and they don't want everybody to come to the actual cemetery.
Who
It's
conduct the ceremony?
their own priest. There's
It's
now
not a Christian, no.
it is now they're all become mostly converted to Christian. So most of them are still sort of Catholic or Anglo, the Anglo Church.
They have their own people as a
As the
priest.
priests, yes. So generally their own priests who conduct it.
In
And
what language?
most of it is in English. In some places, I believe they do have their original mother tongue, especially up in Northern Territory. I believe English is the second language there in Northern Territory. Most of them speak their local language as their first language, like how it is prevalent in India and quite a few places as well. and they
so
don't
do
speak.
They understand English, or particularly in the Cairns area, do everybody understand
yes.
English?
In the Cape, almost all of them understand and speak reasonably good English. Yes, predominantly most of their ceremony up in the Cape area, the English is pretty what they speak. The elder people have a few there who know the local languages they speak, but the new generation now, virtually most of them have no idea of the older languages and their mother tongues, and they don't really know. They have a few words which for them, you know, like brother, thank you, and a few of these kind of things. Most of the, even the younger people are aware of them, and they sometimes use them. But most of the time, it's pretty much English. And as I said, some of them speak some very, very good English. And funnily, I don't know why and how, people who write, or who write reasonable, their writing of the English language is pretty good. It's very clear writing.
The handwriting
is very clear.
Mm-hmm.
And but they are scared to write things. They are scared to make a report. They have no confidence in doing it, and they are even scared to speak publicly, or you know, even address a small group. They feel a bit shy, or I think to me it's a lot of lack of self-confidence.
When you say dress, they have a Western dress, or they have their own way of dressing?
It's mostly Western.
Mostly Western
now.
Mm-hmm.
It's all changed, mostly Western. And they really don't have much of their old stuff left.
Mm-hmm.
Very rare.
So normally what we see in this television, sometimes personal hygiene is a problem in communities there. How far, you know, is it overpopulated, there are more children, you know, how the normal average children in a family, how many children each of them have, and do they have a problem with the personal hygiene?
They really do have extra children, and from that perspective, if you think about it, 3-4 children in a family are quite common. And but having said that, there are some families with smaller, you know, 2 children and you know, things like that as well. They themselves are not very clean and hygienic from a perspective. But when you talk to them, they say, well, when we were living in the jungles or in the rainforest and those areas, they don't have to have a lot of cleanliness. So for them, a little like a, you know, dirty place, it's normal for them. And they don't seem to care too much to keep things very clean. And it's more like a norm for them, like the kids with running noses, they don't clean them. It doesn't seem to bother them. But when you tell them or you point it out to them, then they feel a little kind of, you know, shy, and they feel that maybe, you know, they should. But so, disease-wise, and really,
what is the most common problem they have, common disease among them?
One of them is diabetes. Well, they're definitely very diabetic. I think they don't handle sugar very well. And there are several doctors, especially endocrinologists, who work up at the Cape, who are studying this particular issue. And they feel it's more connected to like the diet they have. Their bodies are not used to so much of sugar, which the new Western society diet.
So what is the normal diet they have? Morning breakfast, what do they have it?
Well, now it's more or less becoming more Westernized, where they have the cereals and...
Milk is available
milk.
In plenty?
Oh yes, milk, plenty of milk available. It's highly Westernized now. It's highly Westernized.
The lunch?
Lunch also, a lot of them prefer to eat like a burger type of a stuff, or...
heavily fat.
Fatty things, but...
chips, potato chips?
Yes, potato chips, all fatty things. They seem to, for some reason, enjoy a lot of Coca-Cola. They, for some reason, they love Coca-Cola.
A lot of sugar.
And that has got a lot of sugar, and it's not good for them. But they seem to have a taste for it, a lot of these things. But when they start going back to their old bush tucker food, what we call their indigenous food from the forests, They then seem to get really good. Very, you know, it seems to help them. The bodies react very well, and it seems to help them a lot. So, like this one guy who had a problem with his leg, he seemed to have developed a gout. And he went to the medical center to get some treatment. It didn't work for him. And so he knew one of his aunts could help him out. So he went back to her, and eventually she helped him out with some things from the, you know, trees. That they went somewhere, I believe a few kilometers, and they found this. They knew what to get. So she made some leaf and something she concoctioned that, and it seemed to work for him, and he was back on feet. And I know about this because he was one of my staff. He was one of the roller drivers, and
they do have a television in every house.
Oh yeah, more or less. Yeah.
So that means they are, you know, all this, you know, how other people are living, all the information are there. They know desire for the improve their quality of living, and at least the, you know, like for example, if people think, you know, we are in a paradise, and you have some people that we think that they are in hell. Do you classify them in hell if you think people ask this kind of questions?
Oh, definitely not. They don't believe they are in hell. A lot of the places they live in, like for example, Lockhart River itself, that place is heaven on earth from a perspective of the natural beauty of the place, the fresh air, the sea water.
Because you consider that as heaven.
Heaven.
But do they consider it as heaven as well?
Yes. I mean, for them, that's one of the reasons why they feel they don't want to leave and come to a city where they call a big smoke.
Well, we left the heaven and we are in the hell now. All relative terms anyway, that's
yes,
fine. You know,
yes.
So. But they seem to be happy, that's most important.
Yes, no, they are very happy where they are, and that's why a lot of them would not like to leave if they can. Bringing up children, etc. is easy. It's a few minutes walk to anywhere, but still people have some cars and vehicles and things like that to go around, because it's everything, they're quite secluded. And they love the beach, they love fishing, they love getting into the ocean. You see small kids, I've seen them swimming in the ocean with their crocodiles. The parents don't say anything. They say, "Oh, just be careful. If you watch a crocodile, just watch it." I mean, kids, maybe, you know, just
fearless, more
fearless, absolutely fearless.
Mm-hmm.
And there are times when I was walking on the beach, and the paradigm drilled into me has been that, you know, be careful of the crocodile. There are crocodiles there, etc.
We are overprotecting our children, not them.
Yes, so they know. They're fearless. They're jumping in. They're pushing.
Because
themselves.
That's the nature of the human, I suppose.
Yes.
You learn through the experience. You know?
Experience. Yes.
Yeah. The normally an average house. How big the house they are?
Well, you see, they.
Who built the house first place?
The first place, the houses are built by the government.
Okay.
It's like social housing. So the governments own those houses, and they give it at a sort of a subsidized rent. Generally, the rent is about a two-bedder would be about $150 to $160 a week. Three-bedder could go up to about $180, $190, and they have some four-bedders as well, which go up to about $200 a week.
That means they must have income, otherwise, of course, take Centrelink.
Yes, and so it's funny how. Yes, Centrelink pays for it, and at their times when the government keeps moving, earlier the Centrelink used to deduct the rent and you know, kind of pay you the balance, but then now the government has started putting the onus on the people, so the people sometimes, you know, take the money from Centrelink and don't pay the rent. So after a while then they kind of, you know, come back and pay a bit of rent, and you know, kind of. They're poor in managing money. They're not very good accountants. They don't understand the dollars quite comfortably and easily.
So very good ground for the people to rob their money.
Yes, and they very easily get robbed. I mean, it's not hard to rob these guys. I mean, in the council as well. I mean, I was giving you an example before. I mean, if they were supposed to get training and, you know, they didn't get it, they just walk away. They don't realize that somebody else has got training. A non-Indian guy has taken the training dollars and got themselves trained. And things like that. But anyway, I mean, they still.
You call it exploitation or what is it?
To some extent, yes, exploitation.
Because of ignorance, sometimes it happened, way of living, it may become a negative for themselves. I mean, they are, you are your own downfall. You are responsible for your own downfall. I mean, you don't knock the door all the time,
Yes. See, they get easily swayed by the people in charge, and
they themselves know very well.
Yes, they so know they, that they're being.
So that means they're exploiting their weakness.
Yes, so it happens. I mean, and these guys, the Aborigines, don't know what to do and how to react. They don't know that the government process has to be followed from A, B, C, D, E, and they have no clue how to follow that process.
Now, this royalties and all sort of thing, Aborigines and kind of thing, there are other issues. There are a lot of things, there are people sitting there and they are getting a lot of money from royalties, how they distribute among the community. These are something people, city side, we hear about it, we don't know. Can you say something a little bit of what's going on there?
See, on the royalties, as you said rightly, quite a few of these corporations set up the indigenous Aboriginal corporations, land trusts, and all which have been set up, are set up to get the royalties into their, bank accounts and things like that. They're also, yes, it's supposed to be a fair divide, going to all the communities and all the people and disadvantaged people. It does happen. It does go to, at times, to quite a few people who are needy. But predominantly, I think, let's say, it's hard to put a figure, but the bulk of it does get to, if the person, chairperson of that or the chairman of that community is from, the person is from X community, the bulk of that funding or that benefits will go to that X community. And 2-3 years later, when there's elections, the person from the other community gets in, he does the same thing. But quite a few times I've seen that monies given are some of the people who need it, like somebody has been very sick or somebody has died, and they've got younger children or younger.
But they don't spend on the projects.
No, it's always for themselves. They don't spend for the projects. They expect the government to put that money in separately.
Mm-hmm.
They don't put too much. They are supposed to put a bit, but they don't put enough. A lot of these corporations are not auditing their accounts properly. There's a lot of misuse from that perspective.
Mm-hmm.
There's no proper accountability. A lot of the people employed are non-indigenous. So pretty much they do what they feel like doing and how they want to do, reward themselves with some good pay rises and increases. So I don't say all of them, but generally that's
it
what seems to be the norm.
Mm-hmm. How is the law and order, how are they maintained by the police, and are they very sympathetic or sometimes they...
That's a very fine line. The police are predominantly, non-Aborigines in the communities. They have a tough time because, you see, one is that the Aborigines believe that they have their own sort of law. And the mainstream law, which is like applicable to you and me and all of us, shouldn't be applicable to them. Like, they travel, for example, in the community, which is about 4-5 kilometer radius. The cars cannot really travel more than 40 kilometers because the roads, by the time you start moving up the street, you have to turn left or right. And it's, sometimes they don't put their seatbelt, there's no car, the kids are sitting in the laps, rather than in a child seat, and they get fined straight away for those kind of things. And so they believe that, hey, we are not doing anything wrong, our kids, nothing is happening, we are looking after, it's no big deal. Okay, one little light is not working or one this thing, we are looking after ourselves, so for these things we shouldn't be penalized. And a lot of times they lose the license for petty offenses like these, which really in their opinion is not a huge amount of negligence. So there's the anger against the police. Some police people are good, they are more practical.
They're doing their job anyway, as far as the government is concerned.
Government's concerned, they're doing the job, but it's like these communities, it's hard, it's hard work.
Hmm.
But some of the police people I've seen have been a bit more lax, and not lax, I would say a bit more practical. They believe that they will come and talk to you, they will even hold. I think And Lockhart, one of the sergeants, was very good. He used to hold 6 monthly meetings, and he used to explain at every public meeting. He used to, you know, request the mayor for about 10-15 minutes, where he used to tell the communities, "We would appreciate if you put the seatbelts on. It's for your safety," and explain to them why, which I thought was very good, because I think, you know, people have to understand why there is a law, rather than this is the law and you do it.
Mm.
So, but there are not too many like him, okay, as well. Mm. Yes,
I think it's a very challenging, you know, work in an environment where, you know, you have a different thinking of your lifestyle, and it is amazing that how, you know, we are accept as they are, then move along. That's the best way to do. But at the same time, we have a country, we have a law, we have a certain things to also. We cannot allow everybody around their own life.
No.
I mean, it's an issue here, particularly a multicultural environment. You know, everybody has some issues here. But anyway, thanks for this small. This is very important to us. To know about their culture, living standard, and also practices. Somehow, of course, it's a very big field, and hopefully another time we can find more time to explore more of that. You know,
surely.
So I'm sure who are watching this, please send your comment so that we can continue this discussions another time. So I think I'm sure that you also can input in the comment on my YouTube.
Oh,
thank you very much for your time.
No, pleasure, Ravi. It's been wonderful, and thank you for the opportunity to, you know, express my knowledge and you know what I believe. I find the Aborigines to be wonderful human beings and great people. I've enjoyed working with them, and hopefully I get more opportunity to continue to work with them. And definitely, yeah, happy to engage more. Thank you very much.
Thank you, bye.
Oh, sweet home, how I love to be back here at home. And that lovely white beach, just as snow white can be. L-O-C-E.